Everybody, welcome to ADC. Today we'll talk about an unusual means of transport. I don't even know if it's correct to call it this way. Some people hate them, others adore them, yet their number is increasing from year to year. We've long been used to taxis, buses or subway in the cities. If they don't suit you, here is a car, bike sharing and something even smaller than bike. Yes, today we're talking about e-scooters. Within last years, this means of transport appeared on city streets all over the world. Some cities like London and New York are trying to ban their use. Despite this, more and more people keep on buying them. It's history that explains why things are happening today, and the kick scooter has more than 200-year history. It has changed a lot, and now it's hard to believe that the invention of kick scooters promoted the appearance of cycles, run bikes for kids, and even motorbikes. Different sources give different information about the person who created the very first kick scooter, but all of them suggest that it was back in the 18th century. The earliest incarnation of the scooter is most frequently connected with the name of Michael Kessler, who lived in Braunsdorf, Germany from 1733 to 1772. Michael Kessler was a wheel and coach craftsman. He worked for the local landlord who lived in Bedrock Castle near Braunsdorf and was always late for work. Once his master told him that he'd better attach wheels to his legs because he wouldn't bear any more delay. So the need made Michael construct a mix of wheelbarrow and a carriage. The device made of wood had a plug-in steering wheel, so it could be controlled while riding. Because of bad roads, he used big wheels and put the seat deeply between them, so he could push off the ground and set the vehicle in motion this way. He also added a second steering wheel because it was difficult to reach the first one located above the big front wheel. He also put a trunk above the rear wheel to set his tools on. Michael's first scooter trip from Braunsdorf to Bedrock Castle was in 1761. His invention is still kept in National Museum in Nuremberg, Germany. Its exact copy is kept in local museum in Braunsbedra town. The other sources consider that the first scooter prototype was created in France in 1791 by Count Medet de Sivrac, who called it celery fur, which can be equivalent of the word speed in English. According to the 19th century advertisement materials, in 1791, Count de Sivrac was riding an unusual vehicle of his own design in Royal Palace Garden in Paris. Two wheels were connected with a wooden bar upon which a seat was placed. Count pushed off the ground and rolled. The construction had no brakes or steering wheel. Some sources suggest that this person never existed and was made up in the 19th century by a well-known French journalist Louis Baudrey de Saunier. The third inventor of the first scooter was Russian craftsman Yefim Artemonov, who created his vehicle in 1800. Unlike two previous versions, the construction was made of metal, its front wheel was bigger than rare, it had a steering wheel and pedals. It's still kept in Perm Regional Museum in Russia. This could be the most progressive concept, however, chemical analysis indicated that the museum exhibit was made according to English samples no earlier than 1870. It would be correct to mention that these three inventions are rather legends, because no evidence that they were created by certain people at a certain period of time were left by contemporaries. Speaking about the next inventor, the situation is different. In 1817, German inventor Carl von Drees created his vehicle, which he called a walking machine. It looked like a run bike for kids nowadays. It had a wooden frame and 30 inches metal rims instead of tires. It weighed about 30 kilos. In 1818, he received a patent for his invention, and this makes him the first official inventor of a kick scooter. In honor of its inventor, contemporaries named his vehicle Drezina. This invention became very popular with postmen and made correspondence delivery four times faster. Carl von Drees was not only an inventor, but also a successful businessman. He started promoting his Drezina. A few years later, it appeared in France, Great Britain, and even the United States. It became a fashionable item of the time. great popularity of the invention helped it to evolve. Inventors experimented with materials and design of main units. For example, the British made a metal body for Dreyzina, and the Germans made up a comfortable saddle. The above-mentioned scooters looked like wooden bikes without pedals, and at that time only men from upper class could afford them. As for the others, they tried to make their vehicles by themselves. Ironically, the best results were achieved by the kids. They made scooters of wooden boards and crates using skate rollers or wooden wheels. The construction rattled hard, and that was the thing kids liked the most. According to the unconfirmed source, 15-year-old boy from London, Walter Linz, invented the scooter concept which looked the way it's known today – small wheels, a platform for feet, and a steering wheel. It was in 1897. The concept was not patented because Walter's father believed that was a child's play, which was not worth spending money on. This version has its supporters and opponents, but it's not officially documented. Only in 1910s the first scooters designed as it's mentioned above were patented. In 1917 metal scooter with a folding handlebar received a patent. At that time most of small scooters were equipped with two rear wheels. The design was considered more stable and safe. However, manufacturers quickly realized that it was much easier to balance while standing than sitting. The production of two-wheeled models began in 1925. We are to say that when the first engines appeared, enthusiasts tried to make their scooters and cycles ride automatically. They used different steamy, gasoline, electric motors and even their combinations. It was more than 100 years ago, and the most difficult thing was to create an engine of suitable dimensions and weight. Every new invention moved engine's evolution one step forward. History of electric scooter creation officially started in the United States on the 31st of December 1895. This is a date when Mr. Ogden Bolton Jr. patented his electric bicycle. The documents added to the patent, including drawings, are still kept in the archives in the United States. His invention was equipped with an electric motor on the rear wheel which utilized direct current along with 6 poles and included 10-volt battery that could produce 100 amperes current. Unfortunately, there is no information that Mr. Bolton's concept was ever constructed. European inventors also motorized two-wheeled vehicles. Though electric motors had bulky and heavy batteries, they were still popular. They were much quieter and not so stinky, but electricity grids were not yet expanded, and as for the gasoline, you could buy it in any drugstore at that time. These concepts were constructed mostly based on bicycles, which were very popular in European cities at the beginning of 20th century. Electric variant of the tandem bicycle named Humber was created in France in 1899. It participated in 24-hour Bolt-Door cycle race in Paris and showed excellent results, but they didn't promote its sales. The inventors thought that the public was not yet ready for the innovation and soon re-equipped it with an internal combustion engine. Nevertheless, the reason was different. Electric installation had 4 batteries and along with 2 riders, the cycle was simply too heavy to ride. Anyway, the company kept selling custom-made electric tandems until 1910, when the model was removed from the catalogs. Some inventors tried to find the way to use internal combustion engines to motorize their cycles. In 1909, a device for cycle modification appeared in England. It was Wall Auto Wheel, designed by Arthur Wall of Guildford. Initially, the concept had a twin cylinder two-stroke engine, which was later modified at a single-cylinder four-stroke. From 1914, the device was manufactured by the BSA company in Birmingham. Its capacity equaled 119cc and maximum speed was 18 miles per hour. The device was promoted widely. According to the ads, even English Prince George of Battenberg had one of them. In 1915, in the United States, the great-grandfather of modern e-scooters appeared. That was a light and maneuverable scooter named Autopad. This motorized scooter was manufactured by the Autopat Company of Long Island City, New York from 1915 to 1922. A patent for the Autopat as a self-propelled vehicle was granted in July 1916. Earlier, the Autopat was described with a hollow steering column that acted as a fuel tank. However, the production version had a fuel tank above the front mudguard. Taking into account the shortage of petrochemicals caused by the First World War, Autopat was a real catch. It still ran on gasoline, but consumed much less than an automobile or motorbike. It was equipped with an air-cooled 4-stroke 155cc engine located over the front wheel, achieving the speed up to 20 miles per hour. The design was based on a children's kick scooter, featuring a standing platform fitted with two 10-inch tires and using handlebar for steering. The machine was operated using only the handlebars and steering column, pushing them forward to engage the clutch using the lever on the handlebar to control the throttle, and pulling handlebars and column back to disengage the clutch and apply the brake. After riding, a steering column could be folded onto the platform to store scooter more easily. The scooter had a headlamp and tail lamp, a klaxon horn and a toolbox. According to Wiki, an electric version with a motor on the front wheel was also available, though it's fair to say that there is no evidence that the engine was electric. Autopat really received a battery whenever any battery company bought the outfit, but it was used for the lighting system and the engine was still running on gasoline. Autopat spread widely among different parts of society, and even managed to cross the ocean and settle down in Europe. It turned so popular that Great German Krupp Corporation started its manufacturing under the license in 1919. Krupp also added an optional seat to Autopat. Primarily, the scooters were bought by the employees of the New York Post Office and served for the quick deliveries, but very soon Autopat became popular among New York gangs. It provided them with fast means of escape from the police through the crowded narrow city streets. In Great Britain, Autopat became a women's rights fighter. Sir Henry Norman, a journalist, liberal politician and a member of British Parliament, presented it as a gift to his wife Florence Priscilla Norman in 1916. Yes, its her photo was spread widely in the internet when the first generation of e-scooters appeared in 2010. Then it was described as the first electric scooter, which is not exactly correct as we already know. As for Mrs. Norman, same as her mother Laura McLaren. Florence also was a member of the suffragette movement that fought for women's rights. Supported in her struggle by her husband, she was the first woman to appear on London streets riding Autopat. At that time, it was a great challenge to the strict moral norms in British society. Over the time, the Autopat became a common sight, further models became faster, more comfortable and stable. In the interwar period, the device was used by the armed forces as a handy vehicle on the military bases and the airfields. Despite its great success, the machine quickly went out of production. It was in 1921 in the United States and in 1922 in Germany. Experts among the contemporaries suggested that the problem could be related to the need of this device. The cost of the Autopat was $100, which was a significant amount of money at the time. It was more expensive than a bicycle, besides it didn't offer a seated comfort of a motorcycle. One more reason was that in the meantime, a number of other companies started producing and marketing similar concepts, which were faster and more comfortable. A lot of scooters appeared by 1920 in Europe and the United States. Among them, Alvin Scooter, Otto Glider, Otto Scott, Kingsbury, Macklem, Scooter Motor, and others. They were like Autopat, but most of them already had seats and soon turned into mopeds. By 1920s, bicycles became one of the cheapest means of transport, which made them very popular with young people. Besides, engine size reduction allowed many enthusiasts to motorize their bicycles themselves. Future Hollywood producer, air constructor, millionaire, and the person who made around the world flight, Howard Hughes, created his motorized bicycle at the age of 13. It was in 1918 when he equipped his bicycle with a motor of his own using some parts of his father's steam engine, which he remade for gasoline. By the way, he is one of the creators of H4 Hercules flying boat, and we'll have a talk about it once. In 1920, German company named Heinzmann managed to start mass production of electric motors for bicycles. Their first electric motors were tested on tandem bicycles. Later, the manufacturer engaged the production of engines not only for bicycles, but for many other vehicles and tools. It's an interesting fact that Heinzmann is still producing electric motors in 2020. In 1927, unwilling to lag behind the Germans, French prepared their own version of the electric bicycle, which was called electrocyclette. The electric bike was 1.8 meters long, it had 0.5 HP engine, which could accelerate it to 25 km per hour and drive about 30 km on a single battery charge. Those were amazing results because the electrocyclette weighed about 75 kilos. The battery of the electric bike was removable and could be recharged remotely from the vehicle. Though electrocyclette was not yet economical, compact and fast, it was one of the first electric scooters and many of its concepts are still used by constructors nowadays. In 1930s, Lee J Manufacturing Company of Minneapolis, US presented their idea of Go Bike. Company printed and sold a cheap handbook with a number of DIY projects, most of which were about the electrification of common objects like bicycles. That was a period of the Great Depression, so anything that could save money was more than welcome. The Go Bike was described as an amazing product. It had a range of 70-75 miles for every recharge, even without pedaling. Like Wall Auto Wheel, the motor was mounted on the rear wheel and pushed the bike through a smaller wheel. The handbook served the purpose of attaching potential customers. Most of them surrendered to the complicity of the project and bought the ready-made products which Lee J Company offered. Nevertheless, there is no information if product was actually ever sold, so we can only guess how ready-made Go Bike looked like. Meanwhile, cars were turning more and more available, and people preferred buying them because just recently they were inaccessible luxury items. A period preceding World War II made motorbikes favorites of the time. For several decades, they turned from bicycles with motors into fast and maneuverable vehicles. All the armies of that epoch had motorbikes in service. Many scooter companies changed their models, providing them with bigger saddles and wheels. Cushman Airborne Scooter created the concept which had taken its rightful place in the US Army and the armies of the Allies. During the Second World War, in 1941, in occupied Belgium, Sokkeveld Company started the production of self-titled electric scooters. First 15 models were produced and sold immediately. It was a result of petrol rationing during the German occupation. In 1942, Sokkeveld managed to sell 400 scooters, even despite their high sales price and the difficulties with the batteries and electric motor supply. The parts came from various manufacturers. SS and Moe provided the motors, Presto-Litte and Tudor the batteries, and the frames were made by a company in Liège. Top speed of the Sokkeveld was about 25 km per hour, a range about 50 km, and recharging time amounted up to 10 hours. When the war ended, Sokkeveld started the production of gasoline motorbikes. The electric motor was still available, but not many were sold. It is said that the company had to scrap 80 unsold electric Sokkevelds in the early 50s. After the end of the Second World War, global motorization started. New oil markets appeared and nobody needed complex electric mechanisms and heavy batteries. Now young people were buying cars and bikes that invaded mass market. They were less luxury than cars from 1930s, but still convenient, and best of all, they were much cheaper. Gasoline became cheap and available everywhere. From 1950s, bicycles were either associated with farmers or lower class. Enthusiasts were still creating electric-powered two-wheeled vehicles, but they were either custom or sold in small quantities. As for the kick scooters, they were now perceived as children's toys. However, in some countries like Czech Republic, Poland, and Australia, kick scooters were still used in everyday life, sports, and even business trips around the city. From now, cars and bikes relegated motorized scooters to the second place. This could be the end of the story, but the concept of small two-wheeled motorized vehicles moved from the west to the east.